Today's episode is sponsored by Midwest Fire. For more than 20 years, Midwest Fire has been manufacturing high-quality tankers, tanker pumpers, and fire rescue vehicles in the United States and Canada. Keeping firefighters safe while enhancing their capabilities is what they do best. To learn more, go to MidwestFire.com. Everybody look at your hands. Oh, we can dance, oh, we can dance. Everybody's taking the chance. It's safe to dance. Oh, it's safe to dance. Hey, it's safe to dance. Hello and welcome to episode 241 of the Situation Awareness Matters show. I'm your host, Rich Gassaway. The purpose of this show is to help improve situational awareness and high-risk decision-making for individuals and teams who work in high-stress, high-consequence, time-compressed environments with changing conditions. The SA Matters mission is simple. We want to help you see the bad things coming in time to avoid bad outcomes. I'm coming to you today from Fort McMurray, Alberta, Canada, where I'm about halfway through delivering 15 situational awareness programs for oil refinery operators for Syncrude Canada. And I've completed one of the two programs we're doing for the first responders throughout the region. Today's feature segment is a continuation of a series of flashback episodes that I'm running from the early days of the SA Matters show. When I first launched this show back in May of 2014, I had some amazing guests who shared some incredible near-miss stories. The problem is the show was new, really new, and we had not gained much of a followership, at least not the followership like we have today. So I want to give the listeners and the viewers who were not with us back then an opportunity to learn from some of these very powerful stories. Now, for those who may be watching this episode on our SA Matters TV YouTube channel, the interview that's coming up is audio-only segment because we weren't recording video interviews with our guests back then. Everything on the episode leading up to and following the interview will be video. Before I jump into the feature segment, I'd like to take another moment to mention a special that I'm offering on enrollment in the SA Matters Online Academy. Most first responders have received little or no training on situational awareness and high-risk decision-making. This might be funny if it weren't so tragic. Did you know that issues related to situational awareness and flawed decision-making are among the leading contributing factors in near misses and casualty reports? And many times the issues that lead to the casualty may have been avoided if only the responder or responders had developed and maintained strong situational awareness. I am on a quest to fix this problem, and I really want to help improve your safety and your decision making, and I really want to help you to accomplish the most important goal of all, and that's to go home to the ones who love you. And I hope with all my being that you want the same thing too. If you do, let me help you. I've put together an incredible offer for fire departments that I'm now extending through the end of the year. Your department can enroll up to 100 members for a flat fee of $2,999. Let me give you some perspective on how good of a deal that is. The regular tuition for the academy is $199 a person. Even if your department enrolls less than 100 members, it's still a great bargain. To learn more, visit the SAMatters.com website and click on the green box on the right side of the homepage labeled Online Academy. If you want to enroll or maybe just have some questions, just send me an email at support@richgassaway.com or give me a call at 612-548-4424. As a friendly reminder, this offer will expire at the end of the year, December 31st. Okay, let's jump into our feature segment, a flashback to my interview with Eric Dreiman discussing a flashover event that if circumstances were just slightly different, it could have killed him.
It was Sunday, November the 14th, 2010. I was lieutenant This is Lieutenant Eric Dreiman. I was assigned to Ladder 19. It's my regular station assignment. Typical Sunday shift at the firehouse. We had a few alarm runs, EMS runs, things like that earlier in the day. Station 19 has an engine and a ladder company assigned to that firehouse. We're also one of the two hazardous materials teams for the Indianapolis Fire Department. So we also have two hazmat apparatus at our station that we respond with for hazardous materials runs.
Eric, where in the city is Station 19? Just a, you know, if somebody is not familiar with Indianapolis and they're looking at a phase clock, you know, where would it be?
Okay, well, we're just outside of the downtown area, so we'd probably be between the 6 and 7 position on the clock from city center. So
okay,
just a little bit southwest of downtown Indianapolis.
Okay, that helps. Thanks.
Yeah. So engine and ladder 19 are both staffed with typically staffed with 4 firefighters. On this particular day, due to some staffing issues that we had in the battalion, my ladder company was only running with 3. So we call that running short rather than the typical 4 firefighters that are assigned. We had myself and one of the other regular firefighters that's assigned to ladder 19. And we had one firefighter that particular day who was there on overtime. So normally the gentleman that was working with us that day, we don't normally work with him, but we both, both myself and the other gentleman on the ladder knew him. And so we had, you know, a relationship together. So I guess it was about just a few minutes before noon, 11:59, we get dispatched to a report of a residence fire at 651 Holly Avenue, which in relationship to the firehouse is probably, well, definitely less than a half mile, somewhere between a quarter and a half a mile from the firehouse. So we get dispatched. We know we're going to be the first due engine and ladder to the scene there. And as we were pulling out of the station, we had an obvious column of smoke in the sky, so we had a pretty good idea that something was on fire. You know, at that point we weren't sure what, but having been dispatched as a residence fire, we kind of got into that mode, assuming that we were going to pull up and we were going to have a fire. So it took us about two minutes from dispatch, from the time the run went out, to arrive on the scene. And Engine 19, who was housed there with us, they arrived on scene first. Advised they had a one-story residence with heavy fire showing from the rear. The way the house was oriented to the firehouse, the front of the residence actually faced away from the firehouse. So as we were pulling up, we were seeing the seaside, the rear of the residence, so we could see the heavy fire blowing out the back door of the residence and a small window that looked like it probably belonged to a utility or a bathroom. Heavy fire, 10 to 15 feet in the air, heavy black smoke showing from the rear. There was a plug right on the corner, so Engine 19 stopped and caught the hydrant, laid out a 3-inch supply line, which is our standard supply line for a residential fire of this size, a smaller bungalow type house. As they were catching the hydrant, Ladder 19 proceeded past Engine 19, and we parked in the front of the residence. I got off the ladder and completed a 360. Again, the only fire that was showing was from the rear. Made my way back around to the front, the A side of the residence, and there was a little porch on the front of the residence. And there was an elderly lady sitting on a little bench, just like it was she was sitting on the porch on a Sunday morning watching the traffic go by. And it kind of struck me as funny that she's just sitting here and her house is just blazing away in the back. And so I said, "Ma'am, you need to get down off the porch so that we can go in and fight this fire." And I noticed it was at that point that I noticed she had two black streaks coming down from her nostrils, and at that point it you know, the light went off, and I realized this lady had been in there. She wasn't just sitting on the front porch unaware that her house was on fire. So I asked her, I said, is there anyone else in the residence? And she said, yes, I think my son's in there, or I think my son is still inside. So about this time, my partner and I are masking up, and the engine officer came up to the front porch, and his name is Lauren. I said, Lauren, I said, she thinks her son's still inside. We're going to go ahead in and initiate a search. He said, no problem. We'll be right behind you. And as we were masking up, the engine crew was stretching their dry hand line up to the porch, getting it flaked out in the yard. I turned back to Lauren as we were proceeding through the door. We put our face pieces on, and I said, we're going to go right when you guys come in. So he said, all right, we'll be in right behind you. And this house had a storm door on the front of it with full glass panel running the length of the door. And then it had a solid core wooden door on the interior. So when we made entry, I pushed the wooden door open, and my partner Brian, I sent him to the right to initiate a search, and then I proceeded in after him, and the automatic closer on the storm door pulled the storm door shut. So the solid door, residential door, was open, but you could still see out through the glass through the storm door. So Brian proceeded to initiate his search, and he and I are communicating. And I was a bit concerned about the volume of fire coming out of the rear of the residence. But when we made entry, the smoke conditions were minimal, maybe a foot or two off the ceiling, but still very clear. You could see across the room without much trouble. So I'm in the living room communicating with Brian as he's performing the search, making sure that he's staying oriented. I'm checking the living room itself.
Hey, Eric.
Yes.
With the smoke conditions like a foot off the ceiling.
Yeah.
Were you guys? And I'm just curious. Were you standing up or crawling?
No, we were down.
Okay, I didn't know with that light smoke condition if you were down or if you were up. Okay, go ahead.
No, we were down. Okay. And so Brian went to the right. I had a thermal imaging camera with me, and was periodically checking the rear, the areas that were smokier towards the rear of the residence, doing my best to search those areas with my camera to see if I could find this son that this lady had told me was in the residence. About that time, I started to notice. First of all, I'm thinking, where's that line? Because they should be in here by now. And at the same time, I noticed that the fire in the rear of the residence was starting to intensify. And so I'm talking to Brian, and he's continuing to search. I think there were there was two bedrooms. He had finished the first one and had started the second one. And about that time, I noticed that the heat really started to increase. Started to feel like, you know, things are getting close here. We don't have much time left before things are going to go south, and we're going to have to get out of here. And the whole time I'm thinking, well, the line's coming through the door any second, because when we made entry to initiate our search, they were standing on the front porch with the dry line, just and the lieutenant was getting ready to call for water. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I was kind of probably going a little bit longer in there than maybe I would have otherwise, simply because I knew that the line was standing, you know, they were standing on the front porch with the line, and they should be coming through the door any second. Mm-hmm. As I was looking through my camera at one point, I noticed that the temperature bar on the side of the thermal imaging camera had increased quite a bit. And then it was at that point that I started to notice the smoke conditions, that they began to change. What was a relatively clear environment for us to be in had gotten much smokier, much hotter, and I at that point had almost made the decision that we were going to back out. And then I noticed my knees starting to get warm, and as I was looking out across the residence towards the rear of the residence to take a look at the fire conditions, I noticed that there were little fingers or snakes, as we call them sometimes, of flame kind of floating in the air just above my head. And anyone who's ever either been in a flashover or been through the flashover chamber itself knows that's a pretty ominous sign that you're dealing with an imminent flashover. So I immediately turned to my right and I yelled at Brian and I said, "Brian, we got to go." And at this point, I was probably 8 to 10 feet away from the front door. Brian was probably a similar distance to my right away from the front door. So I turned around and proceeded straight back to the wall where I knew the door was. At this point, the smoke conditions had gotten to the point where I couldn't see very well at all. I could see my hand in front of my face, maybe out to a foot or two, but visibility had definitely diminished from what it was when we first made entry. And I began to sweep the wall, and for some reason, and I don't know why, probably a little bit of it was just my rush to get out. I had difficulty locating the handle on the door. And just as I located the handle on the door, I started to push it open, and the whole room flashed over. I pushed Brian out ahead of me and made sure that he got out. And then I essentially tumbled out on top of him. I landed on top of Brian. Fortunately we both made it out. The lieutenant on the engine said that, when he saw that the room flash just that split second before we made it, exit, he said he thought he had just seen, two of his friends die in there because he saw how bad it was. We rolled out. I was on fire. Brian was on fire. Our turnout gear, was flaming up. So the engine crew finally got water. There was a delay with the attack line getting water. But once they finally got it, they got it in time to hose both of us down and put us out. So Brian and I rolled off the porch with a few unsavory four-letter words as we were kind of regathering ourselves. And I asked him, I made sure he was okay. I said, "Are you okay?" And he said, "Yeah, I'm okay." I said, "Are you burned anywhere?" He said, "No, I don't think so." So I felt the same way, probably mostly because of adrenaline at the time, just the whole situation itself. But so we regathered ourselves, picked up our hand tools, and then we proceeded to turn around and go back in and assist the engine crew with fighting the fire and opening up areas of the residence that needed opened up, and then continue our search. Ultimately, there was no one else in the structure. The lady's son had gotten out. I'm not sure how, but he had originally been in the residence when the fire started, but subsequently had exited the structure prior to the fire department's arrival. So
was he not there?
No, he was there. He was there when the fire started.
No. Was he there when you guys got there?
No, he was not.
So he fled the scene.
He had. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he had fled the scene.
Okay.
And the reason that he fled the scene, we found out ultimately, was because he had a meth lab in the rear of the residence. And that's what actually had started the fire. The meth lab had exploded. Ironically, our engine ended up making a run on him 2 or 3 hours later, when they got called to a alley in a neighborhood near where this fire had occurred for a burned person. And so they ultimately ended up treating this gentleman for the burns that he has sustained at the at this fire. But it was a few hours later. But he had second and third degree burns to his upper body from where he had been caught in the initial flash or explosion from the meth lab lighting off. So then we ended up going back in. I noticed that my my right ankle, I could tell that I'd gotten some steam burn or something on my right ankle because it was really not bothering me to the point where I couldn't function, but it was annoying. I knew it was there. I was in pain on my right ankle. But at the same time, you know, I've gotten minor steam burns before at other fires, you know, other little burns here and there. So I didn't think it was anything too significant. So we proceeded to finish the work that needed to be done in there. Additional crews had subsequently arrived on the scene. We normally get on a residence fire in Indianapolis, just for a single family residence, we'll get two engines and two ladders, typically all staffed with four people. So, and then we get a squad company and a battalion chief and a safety officer. So, but by this point, there's roughly 20 people on the fire ground that are there to, you know, deal with this situation. So once the initial fire was knocked down, second truck crew came in, completed the secondary search for us. And then my partner and I made our way out. By that time, we needed air. Our air bottles were, our vibro alerts were going off on our air bottles. So went outside, and it was at that point that I realized how close we had really come to being significantly injured, if not killed in there. I took my SCBA off, the gauge that hangs on the front of my SCBA, my air pressure gauge, the screen on it. The first thing I noticed was that it was jet black with soot. It was just completely covered. I took my air pack off, laid it on the ground to change the bottle. Then I looked down at the base of the bottle, and the gauge next to the hand wheel for the main valve for the bottle, that gauge was completely burnt away. The clear, the clear panel that you can read the pressure through had melted away. The numbers and everything on the inside of the gauge were all burnt away. My helmet was a red fire helmet when I started the day. When I came out, all the paint had been burnt off of it, all the reflective trim. My hood had pretty significant scorch marks all around the exposed areas that weren't either up inside my helmet or down below my collar on my bunker coat. My face piece was melted, the lens itself, the regulator. And then I took my coat off to cool down. And it was at that point when I laid my coat down on the ground that I had a hole burnt and basically where your shoulder blades are on each side of the back of my bunker coat, where the fire gear had done its job, but the outer shell had been, you know, heated and burnt to the point where it burned a hole through the outer shell on both shoulders, both shoulder blades. And the only thing that was basically there between me and the outside environment was the inner liner and the vapor barrier. So at this point, I realized that, hey, I probably need to be looked at because, you know, I started to, I think the adrenaline was kind of wearing off, and I had started to realize that my ears felt funny, my neck felt funny, those sorts of things. So I went over to one of the other firefighters on the scene, and I said, how do my ears look? Because I had felt them, and I didn't feel, you know, I didn't feel any crispy critter feeling or anything like that, but I didn't have a mirror or anything to look at him. So I asked this guy, I said, how do my ears look? And he said, oh man, he said, yeah, your ears are burnt. He said, we need to get you, you know, you're going to need to go to the hospital. So I ended up getting transported, and my partner that was there, he suffered, some minor burns where his, turnout coat or his SCBA straps had compressed the bunker gear on, you know, on the front of his coat. He suffered some contact burns there. He chose not to seek evaluation or treatment. His were relatively minor. My burns ended up being second-degree burns to both ears, the back of my neck. I had one spot on the left side of my face where apparently there was a gap between my Nomex hood and my face piece. I had some secondary burns there. I had burns on the back of my left hand, and then my ankle. I just had a steam burn there. But so I was pretty lucky. Initially, they didn't know if I would need to be hospitalized or how significant the burns were. We have a pretty good burn unit here in Indianapolis. And after evaluating me, they opted not to hospitalize me, to cut me loose and send me back to the firehouse. I subsequently was sent home for the remainder of the shift by the on-duty safety officer because I had my burns had started to blister. You know, I had bandages on both ears, those sorts of things. Obviously, it's not the kind of thing that you can be making runs when you're in that condition. So I was essentially relieved of duty for the remainder of the day, placed on line of duty injury. And then my partner that was there, he ended up finishing out the rest of the shift. And the other firefighter, the third firefighter that was on the ladder with us, who was driving the ladder that day, the way we operate is we split crews. So the engineer chauffeur for the ladder, his responsibilities were exterior ladder company functions like horizontal ventilation, securing utilities, forcing the rear door if it's needed, laddering the structure when it's needed, those sorts of things. So he never was inside with us during the initial search when the flashover occurred. Once his exterior duties were completed, he then came inside with us and assisted us with overhaul and finishing up the primary search. So he was fortunate that he wasn't in there with us, because if he had been, he probably would have ended up in a similar state to Brian and myself. Mm-hmm. So
let me ask you a couple questions.
Yeah.
The time from your entry, in other mm-hmm. words, you crossed from the threshold from the outside to the inside, mm-hmm. until the flashover actually occurred, about how long would you estimate that?
Well, I've thought about that quite a bit over the last 5+ years, and the best I can guess is probably between a minute and a minute and a half from the time we made entry until the flashover occurred.
Okay, so when the engine was delayed in getting water, we're not talking a 5-minute delay here. We're talking seconds to a minute.
Correct.
Which,
yes.
in the scheme of getting water to a hose line, is a minuscule amount of time. There was not some big delay here. It was just a minor 0.5 minute to 1 minute difference there.
Correct. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. The next question I have for you mm-hmm. is what specifically were the triggers, if you can remember, what specifically mm-hmm. were the triggers when you guys were in there that compelled you to turn to Brian and say, "We're leaving"?
Mm-hmm.
Well, because you're on a search. So that's right. That's not an easy thing to do on a search, is to turn to your partner and say, tap him on the shoulder and say, "We are now abandoning the search for the victim, and we are in full bore save ourselves survival mode." Now, I'm sure you probably didn't use those words, but that's probably mm-hmm. similar to what's going through your mind. So what was it that triggered this that caused you to? That's a hard decision to make. I mean, you had to make like one of the toughest decisions that we make, and that is it's time to save ourselves. So talk me through that.
Yeah, well, ultimately the defining point for me was when I started to see those little fingers of basically, just if you can just imagine, for those people who have been through the flashover chamber, they know what I'm talking about, or witnessed a flashover, but just little strips or fingers of flame just suspended in midair, floating through the air, not attached to anything. That's basically, you know, the fire gases inside the structure have reached their ignition temperature, and they're spontaneously lighting off. That was ultimately what made me decide that we needed to go.
Thank you, Eric Dreiman, for participating in this interview and sharing your lessons learned with our listeners and our viewers. Since 2007, SA Matters instructors have helped more than 1,200 organizations and more than 67,000 individuals improve high-risk decision-making, including first responders, industrial workers, military personnel, business leaders, medical professionals, utility workers, highway workers, school bus drivers, aviation workers, oil refinery operators, and more. If you work in a high-risk, high-consequence decision-making environment, then we're here to help improve your safety and your survival, and to help you accomplish the most important mission of all, and that is to go home to the ones who love you. I'd like to take a moment to honor and thank the companies, organizations, agencies, and departments that have hosted recent Situation Awareness Matters training for their team members: the Anderson County Fire Department in Anderson, South Carolina, the University Heights Fire Department in University Heights, Ohio, the International Association of Fire Chiefs Volunteer and Combination Officer Section Symposium in the Sun in Clearwater Beach, Florida, the Rogue Interagency Training Association in Medford, Oregon, the Shoreline Fire Department in Shoreline, Washington.
Welcome to Chief Miller. Chief Miller operates the largest social media page dedicated to the men and women of the fire service from around the world. Check him out on Instagram at Chief_Miller. Find him on Twitter at Chief_Miller. And check out the website where you can find Chief Miller Apparel at ChiefMillerApparel.com.
If you're interested in attending one of our programs, here's where we're going to be upcoming. Where I'm at currently through December 11th, at the Syncrude Oil Refinery in Fort McMurray, Alberta. January 3 through 9, we'll be back at the Syncrude Oil Refinery in Fort McMurray. January 12th at the Quad County Fire Chiefs Association in Lewiston, Idaho. January 15 and 16 at the Pearland Fire Department in Pearland, Texas. January 26th at the Toledo Fire Department in Toledo, Ohio. February 2 and 3, the Missouri Winter Fire School in Columbia, Missouri. February 22nd, the West Virginia Emergency Services Conference in Pipestem, West Virginia. March 4 through 8, we'll be doing a North Shore tour in Minnesota, which will include Grand Rapids, Hibbing, Mountain Iron, and Lutzen, Minnesota. March 12th, the Maryland Fire Rescue Institute National Fire Service Staff and Command Program in Towson, Maryland. March 25 through April 3, the Pearl Harbor Naval Shipyard in Oahu, Hawaii.
I think Rich's ability to connect with any crowd, that's a gift that he has, and it's easily transferable.
This is the second or third time that I've heard him speak. There's some teeth to the information that he brings.
It's been really good. Good mixes. He knows when to throw in a joke here and there to get you back involved.
Some tools. I'm a new lieutenant, so very, very interesting. And some of these things I can take back to the station and use with some of the new firefighters I have on my crew.
Something to get you thinking about your job more, big picture type stuff. I've seen him before. A good review for sure.
I have heard him before, yes. After he speaks, there's usually an enlightenment because now they're more aware of what's going on around them and what they're experiencing as they're responding to calls.
He's very, very knowledgeable. I'm enjoying it so far.
And that intuition, that's a big one. The video that he just showed up here, we're getting a lot out of this. I think this is a really good seminar, especially for new people and old. So I think it's very informative. This talk gives us more ammunition to do all three.
They're relatable to what we have experienced or very well could experience, so it makes it easy to let the knowledge sink in.
I mean, it's awesome. A lot of stories you can usually relate to yourself and calls you have been on, you know, aha moment. Like, he just helps you focus on picking out the right things. It's awesome. It's a refresher and keeps my eyes open. It's good stuff.
If people listen to the message that he has, it's an incredible message delivered by a very compassionate person. Strategy and tactics are going to always change. situation awareness is it doesn't change. It's always there.
He's got some good stories to tell, and he's very thorough with his stories, and it's interesting listening to him.
Very clear speaker, and he talks on our level because he's been there. He's been in the trenches. I think he's doing well, and I'm looking forward to the second half.
To see the locations of all the upcoming events, just head over to the SA Matters website and click on the blue box on the right side of the homepage labeled Live Training Dates. If you're interested in hosting a program, just click on the Contact Us tab at the top of the SA Matters homepage and I'll give you a call. If you want to become part of the SA Matters community of learners, there's a couple of ways you can do that. Just check the show notes for how to get connected with us through our newsletter membership, podcast subscribers, YouTube subscribers, and how to follow us on the social media channels of Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and Instagram. There we share ideas about how to improve situational awareness, how to make better decisions under stress, and how to improve the skills of critical thinking and resilient problem solving. Well, that's it. Episode 241 of the SA Matters show is complete. Thank you again to my guest, Eric Dreiman, for sharing your story and your lessons learned to help us be safer. Thank you to our awesome sponsors, Midwest Fire and Chief Miller. Thank you to all those companies, agencies, and organizations that have hosted Situational Awareness Matters training programs. Thank you to all the organizations that have hosted a live, virtual, internet-based training event. Thank you to the more than 2,500 students and graduates of the highly acclaimed Situational Awareness Matters Online Academy. Remember that special enrollment for the Academy ends on December 31st. And most importantly, thank you, the listeners and the viewers of this show, for sharing some of your valuable time with me today. I really appreciate your support of the SA Matters mission. Be safe out there, and may the peace of the Lord and strong situational awareness be with you always.
You've been listening to the Situational Awareness Matters radio show with Dr. Richard B. Gassaway. If you are interested in learning more about situational awareness, human factors, and decision-making under stress, visit samatters.com. If you are interested in booking Dr. Gassaway for an upcoming event, visit his personal website at richgassaway.com.